Well, hey, I know you love Mac tips, so here's 10 more you've probably never used. This video is sponsored by Dashlane, the best password manager and digital wallet around. You need proof? I've been a paid user since before they ever thought to sponsor the channel. Visit dashlane.com/snazzylabs to try it out for free today. Tip number one. In macOS Yosemite and later, you have the ability to batch or mass edit file names in Finder, and it's super handy. So in this folder, I've got a bunch of photos that I took in Israel last year. But beyond being in the folder called Tel Aviv, the file names themselves are just a cryptic name that my camera spit out, and they're not very easily searchable or identifiable. Now, of course, I could change the name of one of these files by adding Israel to the beginning, but that's not very efficient, and I have several hundred photos. Well, I can select all and then right-click, and then go down to where it says rename 154 items. And there are multiple options for me to batch edit these file names. I can either change DSC to Israel or something along those lines so I get a file like this, or I can actually make a brand new series. So I can call it Tel Aviv, and then start the series with number one and go up sequentially from there. And you'll see I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and I've got this very, very handy, easily digestible file format that's very easily searchable. Tip number two, have you ever been watching or listening to something on your Mac and noticed that one full volume jump is a little bit more than you'd like? Perhaps it's a little too loud, or maybe the very lowest volume setting is still too loud. Well, if you hold down Shift, Option, and then click your volume keys, you can move the volume slider in increments of 1/4. This is awesome for slight micro adjustments or just barely listening to audio through your Mac. Tip number three, if you've ever tried to drag a window in the background around, you'll probably notice that as soon as you click it, it becomes the foreground window, which isn't always what you want. Well, if you are on the foreground window, you can actually hold down the command key as you drag the background window, and it won't become the foreground window, it just stays in the background. Pretty handy little tip. Tip number four, I really like some of the window snapping functions built into recent versions of Windows, and macOS just seems behind in that regard. Now, yes, there are applications like Better Snap Tool that allow you to do your window management a little bit better, but there is at least one slightly rudimentary way to snap panes in macOS 10, and that is if you, before you click the green full screen button, click it and hold down, and then you can actually drag it to the left or right side of the screen. If you drag it to the left side, it finds itself straight down the middle of our screen, and then I can either just work over here or find a second app to go on the other half of the screen. You can actually drag and resize these panes, and no, it's not as powerful as Windows 10 snapping, and you are still in full screen mode, which is a little irritating, so if you want to go back to the Finder, you're going to have to jump out that way, but it does work, and I do use it occasionally. Tip number five. It's Laurel, by the way. If you've ever force-touched on a word on one of the recent MacBooks, you'll have noticed that this little handy little pop-up bar comes up, and it defines the word that you've selected. It'll look for it on Wikipedia. If it's the name of a person or an actor, they'll show up with their movies or their music in iTunes. You'll find web videos about it. You can rent the movie directly from the tab. It's pretty cool. And unfortunately, on an iMac, or at least on an older Mac that doesn't have a force-touch trackpad, it doesn't seem like you can do it. But actually, you can. If you highlight your cursor over the word and then press Control-Command-D, that little pop-up bar will come up. No, it's not as handy as force-touching, but hey, it's something. Tip number six. Okay, this one is cool. We've all heard of remote desktop software like TeamViewer or GoToMeeting, where you can screen share your screen with someone else, or you can even control their desktop. But a lot of people don't know that that's already built in natively to macOS 10 on every single Mac. It's called screen sharing, and you do have to find it in Spotlight. It's not in the applications folder. But once you enter the app, you can either type the IP address of the computer, or the much easier way is to type the Apple ID of the account associated that's logged into that computer. So if I want to log into my other computer here in the office, I just type my own Apple ID, and all of my Macs logged into my Apple ID will get the notification. Or you can type in the Apple ID of someone halfway across the world and they'll get a notification asking if you can see and share and control their screen. So it's a great way to do tech support when you don't want to have to deal with stuff over the phone or you don't want to have to FaceTime telling them what to do. You just do it yourself. Or a really fun thing that you can do is there's actually microphone functionality built in. So not only can you see and control their desktop, but you can actually talk over your iSight camera microphone. It's great for Netflix and long distance chill. Tip number 7. I always feel like this is one that most people know, but then I look at people's menu bars and they're cluttered to the brim with icons. A lot of people don't know that you can rearrange the icons by holding down the command key and then dragging the icon to wherever you want. And a lot of them, especially system icons, can be removed entirely. If I'm always connected to Ethernet and don't need Wi-Fi, I can hold down command, drag it off the menu bar, let go, and it disappears. Now, you can't do that with all third-party icons. A lot of them, these little applets especially, you need to disable them from within the app themselves. But it's a great little way to rearrange stuff, to move it around, and just clean up your status bar. Tip number 8. I feel like most people know that if you right-click the toolbar in a Finder window, you can customize the toolbar really entirely and control what icons are in your main Finder windows. If you want more stuff, if you need less stuff, it's pretty handy. But what a lot of people don't know is that you can drag files or folders into here as well. Now, let's say I hold down the command key and drag this Tel Aviv file, and there you go. Every time I click it, a Tel Aviv folder is going to open. Now you may be thinking, well, that's stupid. Just drag it into the sidebar that's always permanently there. It's clearly designed for that. And that's probably true. But you can also drag, to get rid of these, you hold down the command key and then you just drag it away. But you can also drag applications into here. So let's drag Raw Digger, which is an application that I use a lot, into the toolbar here. Now when I click it, Raw Digger will open. That's pretty cool. But what you can also do is, let's say I'm in the Tel Aviv folder, I've got a raw file, I can just drag the file right onto the little guy and it'll open the application with the file in full view. It's really, really handy if you've got commonly used applications that you want in your menu bar. Number 9. Have you ever used an application that for whatever reason doesn't have shortcuts programmed for some of the menu bar items you use? It's super annoying. Let's take the new Firefox Quantum, for example. I love this browser. It's way better than Chrome. Suck at Chrome users. But the problem is that there are two ways to view the history. When you do Shift Command H, which is the normal history shortcut, it just pops up this little sidebar. But sometimes I want to see the full history window. The problem is that for whatever reason, there isn't a shortcut available. You can see there's no shortcut over here, but that's not a problem because we can create our own. If I go into System Preferences and click Keyboard and then click the Shortcuts tab and then App Shortcuts, I can add a new application-specific shortcut. So you can have it do in all applications if you wanted, but no, I just want this in Firefox. Now you need to type the menu title name of the item that you're trying to engage. So this one is Show All History. And you have to type it exactly as it appears. History. You have to type it with all capitals. If there's periods, like this one, for example, Clear Recent History, you have to do dot, dot, dot at the end. Type it exactly as it appears. And then you give it a new shortcut. So instead of Shift Command H, let's do Shift Command K. I press Add. And then now in Firefox, when I press Shift Command K, the full history window opens, and we can even see here that Show All History now has a programmed hotkey. Very handy. Number 10. iCloud Keychain Access saves every Wi-Fi network password you've ever logged into on any of your devices. And if you forget one, all you have to do is enter the app called Keychain Access, which is in the Utilities section of your Applications folder, click Local Items, and then find the network or the name of the network that you need to remember the password for. Let's say I need the Golden Crown Wi-Fi password, which was a hotel I stayed at in Israel. I click copy password to clipboard. I type in my admin password and it's copied to the clipboard and I can paste it and holy smokes, Golden 2014, there's the password. Now iCloud Keychain can also sync your login credentials for regular websites, but it sucks when compared to Dashlane, the best password manager and digital wallet on the net. Dashlane not only helps you generate strong passwords and store them securely, but it automatically logs you into the websites that you visit. The world was freaking out last week when Twitter leaked a bunch of passwords online. But I wasn't worried because unlike most people who use a single password for everything, I had used Dashlane to create and store a password specific to my Twitter account. So when they leaked, all I had to do was go into Twitter, change my password, and continue on with the rest of my day. In fact, their amazing password changer tool allows you to click one button and Dashlane does the rest of the work for you. They log into your account, they change your password, all without you having to move a muscle. They've got killer mobile apps for both iOS and Android, and they even support autofill, not just in the web browser, but also in supported third-party applications as well. Dashlane's free for one device, so you have no excuse not to try it. But when you do decide to upgrade to Dashlane Premium, use the coupon code SNAZZYLABS at checkout to save an extra 10%. Please give Dashlane a shot, not just because by doing so you'll help my channel, but because Dashlane is genuinely awesome and I love it, and you'll be kicking yourself for not having tried it earlier. I'm Quinn of Snazzy Labs. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, you know what to do. If you didn't enjoy this, well, that other button seems to work okay too. Please check out my other Mac tips videos. They're awesome. You'll enjoy them. Most importantly, and as always, stay snazzy.